If you are still giving your clients a number of photos that you will deliver for each session or are sending, you know, watermarked galleries so that you can upsell those digital files or prints, then you need to stop right now and watch this video.
So today we are breaking down the two most successful wedding and portrait photography business models and really talking about why we think that one of these options is, for most photographers, just kind of better than the others.
Yeah. But before we jump into that, we want to introduce ourselves.
I'm Hunter.
And I'm Sarah.
And we're Hunter and Sarah Photography, a professional husband and wife wedding photography team.
We are also educators, and our goal is to help photographers to build strong foundations in both their businesses and their personal lives so that they can run profitable and sustainable photography businesses.
So in today's video, like I mentioned, we are going to briefly introduce you to the two ways of running a photography business, often called in-person sales and shoot and share. Those are the two different models. Now, the bulk of this video is going to be about why we think that in most cases, photography businesses are going to be better served with that shoot and share model, where you're really selling your time and then just delivering all of the good images rather than selling a certain number of images and trying to make upsells later. So let's dive right in.
So the first model that we are going to discuss is the in-person sales or IPS business model. And even when you aren't it's still called IPS, even when you aren't meeting with those clients in person, maybe you're meeting with them online. But this is where you show your clients a large gallery of images, maybe lightly edited or totally unedited, that are usually heavily watermarked. These images are not theirs to keep, but just to review. And then they choose a small selection of images, or they purchase more images, which you then edit more extensively and deliver digitally or in print form, or maybe both.
So this business model actually stems from the days of film photographies, before digital cameras even existed, where delivering every single image you took at a wedding or on a portrait session was just prohibitively expensive for most photographers and for their clients. And so what you would actually do is you would print off what's called a contact sheet. And this is basically just the negatives from your camera, just sort of all printed off together. Or maybe you might print some smaller prints, sort of low quality prints that you would then, you know, show to your clients. And then they would then choose either from the sheet, maybe they'll circle them, or maybe they pick out some of the smaller prints. And then once they've selected the smaller gallery, then you would go through the sort of slow and painstaking process of actually printing each of your negatives and enlarging them into sort of full format prints. That was sort of the only way to run a business back in the film days.
Yeah, and the advantage of that in-person or IPS sales method is really obvious at first, whether, you know, it's digital or if you're shooting in film, which is those upsells. You know, you can sell a session for $100 and includes just like 5 edited images and end up selling like 20 or 50 of those additional images and make like 10 times your session price that you charged up front. And of course, that is if you have a really solid understanding of how to price yourself, how to price your work, and how to sell on the back end.
And that if is doing a lot of work there. That is a really important if. This process can be much less work in terms of editing because you are just editing fewer photos. But if you're not a strong salesperson or you don't know how to take your customers on a buying journey, on a purchasing journey, then you can just end up doing a lot of sessions for a really low session fee and not making any sales on the back end, which basically ends up your clients get sort of a meh experience because they only got a few images. And you just basically feel terrible because you're missing sale after sale and doing a ton of sessions for not a lot of money.
Yeah. So the other method is what people call the shoot and share method. This is where your clients just pay one price upfront and you capture their session or maybe their wedding day. You retouch all of what we call those deliverable images.
So that's getting rid of the blurs, the blinks, the duplicates, the unflattering images, you know, something you wouldn't want anyone to see.
Yeah, send them to your clients via an online gallery and that's it.
So to be clear, your clients can still purchase prints and albums through you because they have the digital files, they're not like locked into buying from you, which they obviously would be if you were withholding all of that, which is often how the IPS photographer makes those big upsells. But at the same time, if you're shooting shoot and share, if you're running your business with that model, you can kind of look at prints and albums as like a fun bonus as opposed to like a necessary part that you have to do in order to keep your business afloat, right? You're gonna make and charge 100% of what you sort of need to make upfront. And then you don't really live or die on the success of your sales method. Whereas with an IPS model, you're charging so low on the front end that you really need to make the sale or it doesn't become like a real tenable business model.
Yeah. And so it's no secret that Hunter and I use the shoot and share model and not the in-person sales model. But like so many photographers that we meet, when we first got started, we listened to those who had been like shooting and photographing in the industry for decades and brought their in-person sales models with them from their days of film into the digital photography days as well. But it didn't take long for us to realize that we didn't like running our business that way, and our clients really didn't like it either.
So the rest of this video is really going to be about why we run a shoot and share wedding photography business and why we think that it's just the best option for most photographers, especially if you want to run a multi six-figure wedding photography business. Now, we're not saying that IPS photographers can't be successful in, you know, the 2020s. Of course, there are successful IPS photographers, but we think a lot of people go there by default when a shoot and share model might make more sense for them.
Yeah. So first and foremost, we have run our business this way because this is what our clients have just always wanted. Year after year, full online galleries of retouched images have just been the main thing that our clients are looking for. Even if like we as photographers know that they will probably only ever print like one or two images or like only set as their phone background like a fraction of those images, all of our past wedding clients from the last 7 years wanted that full gallery.
I mean, that's what we wanted when we got married. Yeah. And this is obviously, we're talking about in the wedding context, right? This is especially true for weddings because those sort of candid moments throughout the day, as well as maybe like fun dancing photos, you know, on the dance floor at the reception, these tend to be pretty important to most of our clients. And this is why we've never added any sort of photo limit to our wedding galleries or our portrait ones for that matter. But so our clients, when they book us, they know they're getting every good image that we take on their wedding day. Now, if people ask us, and only if they ask us, to be clear, we will give them some sort of idea of how many photos they might expect from a wedding day, but we give them this really broad range that is nothing like a photo count. We might say, oh, anywhere between 50 to 125 images per hour of coverage, which across a 10-hour day, that's anywhere from, you know, 500 to 1200 plus.
Yeah. And this was true when we were charging $1,000 weddings, and it's still true now shooting like $10,000 multi-day weddings, that our clients just love the idea of a single upfront price and having access to all of the good images afterwards.
And again, we're not saying that every client in the world wants a full online gallery. And I think this is maybe for portrait photographers, it's not quite so black and white, because sometimes clients really do want a family session for that one photo that they can use as their Christmas card or they can, you know, hang on the wall. But we think, especially when it comes to weddings and especially high-end weddings, that our couples just want online galleries.
Yeah. The second reason that we prefer the shoot and share over the in-person sales is that it's just less work for your clients, which is honestly just a good reason. It's good for a handful of reasons.
Yeah. So for starters, if you send an unculled or more likely a sort of lightly culled gallery of images and then ask your clients to choose their favorites, you're essentially asking them to cull their own galleries, right? And so whether you're sending them 1,000 wedding photos and telling them to choose their favorite 50, or you're sending them, you know, 50 portrait photos and asking them to choose their favorite 5, like, you guys know, like we do, that culling takes time, and you're basically taking that from you and giving it to your clients.
Yeah, and on top of that, they're either doing that during an actual sales meeting, which you have to email back and forth to set up, take the time to then actually do that meeting, mm-hmm. or they go through some sort of like online process where they make the selections and you make the sale.
And either way, at least some part of this sales process is going to require time and effort from your clients. And we just know from experience, anytime you ask your clients to do something, you're basically increasing the likelihood that they just never really get around to it.
Yeah, whether it's like selecting their favorite images for an album or just filling out a questionnaire ahead of the session, some small percentage of your clients are going to do it immediately, right away. Another small percentage will literally never do it. And then like the vast majority will eventually do it, but they're going to need multiple follow-ups and reminders to get there.
And so not only does this add, obviously, time and effort and more emails for you to send, but from your client's perspective, this is just more work and more time as compared to, like, you know, they just get an email 4 to 6 weeks after their wedding and boom, there's their full gallery, or, you know, 3 weeks after their portrait session, whatever your turnaround would be. And then, of course, we mentioned a minute ago, there's some small percentage who will just never get around to choosing their favorite. So maybe you send them those five images and that's good enough for them. And so you never get to make an upsell.
Yeah. Another way that we found that in-person sales can actually diminish your client's experience and therefore lead to those like negative online reviews and fewer recommendations from friends is actually what we call the bait and switch problem.
And so this is a problem unique to IPS photographers where you need to be super incredibly abundantly clear if you're going to run this sales model so that your clients understand what is and isn't included with the session, right? And so unless you're super clear about it, you may get a client who maybe they think that they paid for everything up front. And then when they find out they actually now have to buy the images separately, like they're going to be pissed, right? Because you missed their expectations. Or maybe they think they're getting a full gallery. And so when they only get five and the rest of the images are $5 or $50 each, they're going to feel like you're basically extorting them to get what they think they already paid for. Now, to be clear, this is only a problem if you are or this is usually only going to be a problem if you are running the IPS sales model and you're just like not clear and upfront about your pricing.
Yeah. And it's tricky because you can be clear and upfront about your pricing and someone just didn't read your email, didn't read your price sheet, just didn't realize it for some reason. They just missed it, didn't read it, didn't realize. And they're just like confused and disappointed anyways.
Yeah. And we're sharing the story because this literally happened to a former coworker of ours who hired a photographer, not realizing she was running an IPS business model. And then after their newborn session, when they found out they had to spend like three times as much to buy the images afterwards, they were pissed, they were disappointed, and it kind of ruined the whole experience for them.
Yeah. Now, the third reason that we prefer the shoot and share model is because since your clients know exactly how much they are going to pay for that full gallery, they're willing to spend a little more up front. You know, for the vast majority of people, if what you'll pay later on down the road is uncertain, you're going to pay a little less upfront just to be safe.
So, for example, if your clients don't know whether they're going to be spending $100 after the portrait session or $1,000 after the portrait session, they're going to be a little more hesitant and maybe less willing to pay more upfront because they're sort of mentally preparing themselves to be sold to on the back end, right? And so, as you can probably imagine, this drives your session fee, that money you make upfront, down lower, which then puts more and more pressure on that after-the-fact sales. And that's the last thing any of us need is more pressure to perform in our jobs, yeah, right?
But on the other hand, if your clients are confident that they are getting everything that they need up front, they might be, you know, a little more willing to stretch their budget to get that perfect photographer, you know, you.
Now, of course, you can still, like I mentioned, you can upsell prints and albums after the fact, even with a shoot and share model, but there's not that same pressure to make the sale, right? You and your clients, you charged and they paid for exactly what everyone wanted up front. And so like, maybe you'll make some sales, maybe you won't, right? So last year we made something like $11,000, $11,000 from prints and albums, which was certainly nice, but that was like less than 5% of our total sales. So like, it was nice, but it's not like that made or didn't make our year last year.
Yeah, and that extra, you know, $11,000 came with zero pressure on us. We attached that gallery, like we attached the ability to buy prints onto our online gallery, so people just go in and buy it if they want it.
Which we have a whole video about right here.
Check it out. But if you love making the sales and you're confident in that environment, then like maybe in-person sales is for you. Yeah. But if you aren't a master salesperson, like you may have more peace of mind by just making one sale upfront and then just getting to do what you love most, which is take photos.
And to be clear, you will have to have some level of success as a salesperson if you run your own business, of course. But if you don't enjoy it, don't double the amount of sales meetings you need when you could just do one upfront and then just get on to taking photos. So anyway, moving on. The fourth reason that we chose to run a shoot and share over an in-person sales model doesn't actually have anything to do with sales, but is actually about editing process.
Yeah, so most in-person sale photographers that we know edit their images in Photoshop, while most shoot and share photographers we know, like ourselves, edit in Lightroom. And if you saw our Lightroom versus Photoshop video, you know why this makes sense. And, you know, Photoshop is great for those really in-depth, you know, edits for a small number of images, whereas, you know, that's perfect for in-person sales photographers, whereas Lightroom is essential for just retouching large quantities of photos.
But the thing is, when you're batch editing in Lightroom like that, creating a consistent gallery of images with the same edit all the way across becomes way easier than if you're trying to edit the photos one by one in Photoshop and still somehow create a cohesive work of art.
And this also leads us to the biggest downside of the shoot and share model, which is just all of that extra editing. Like, obviously, if you're delivering 50 or 100 or like 200 photos for a portrait session and like hundreds or like even 1,000 plus photos for a wedding, that's way more editing that you need to do than just like a small selection of just a few images from like an hour of color.
Yeah, we're not going to pretend like shoot and share is all benefits with no downside, right? We do spend a lot of time editing, but we don't mind it nearly as much because Lightroom just makes batch editing so easy. And so, by the way, if you are currently editing in Photoshop, if you're not familiar with Lightroom, or you don't know how batch editing works, we actually have an entire video series that we did earlier this year that is all about the, you know, the backup, the culling, the blogging, the editing, and the delivery of galleries through Lightroom. And you can find the first video in that series right here.
Mm-hmm. But maybe you are watching this video and you're thinking like, Hunter and Sarah, you don't have to convince me. I already do the shoot and share model, so I can have a photo count just as like a guide, right? I'm good. But no.
No. We think that even if you are running a shoot and share business model, you still shouldn't have photo counts. And when you like sell your sessions on your website, don't list how many photos they'll get. No photo counts anywhere.
Yeah. We just want to make sure that you guys are taking into account like the things that you have no control over. Yeah. Like, what if it rains or it's like really bad weather? What if your client shows up heckin' late? Or maybe they're like, the session's just moving slow. Who knows why? There's any number of reasons that a session could just be moving more slowly. Or maybe their kids or their dogs aren't cooperating.
What if you just have a bad day?
Yeah.
Like, right? They happen sometimes.
Yeah, you could just be forced to deliver like bad images just to meet that minimum number that you promise. And those are images that you don't want to be tagged in, maybe.
Yeah. And now on the flip side, like, what if the session is just going great and your clients are crushing it and everything's going great and you are just like taking the best images of your life? Like, you might feel a little bit of pressure to like withhold some of those like really high quality images from your clients just because you made some sort of arbitrary photo count, you know,
per hour session. Yeah, you finna not send them good photos.
Yeah, like, right? Of course you're going to deliver those.
Yeah. At the end of the day, there's really only one reason to give a photo count, and that is to limit the number of images that your clients have access to in order to make those upsells after the session. So if you don't want to run in-person sales model, then get rid of photo counts altogether. Instead, just sell your time.
Running a shoot and share business with photo counts is literally the worst of both worlds. So just get rid of it. Like Sarah said, sell your time. So if you're a portrait photographer, maybe you're selling 20 to 30 minute sessions. Maybe like us, they're 75 to 90 minutes. It doesn't really matter. And then when it comes to your, you know, wedding coverage, just sell your wedding days based on hours of coverage. Now, we could get talking about pricing and minimum hours and all that stuff. But the point is, no matter what you're shooting, rather than telling them, oh, you will get 15 images per hour of coverage or whatever it is, just tell them like, hey, we're going to shoot for an hour. And at the end of the day, you're going to get all of the good images lightly retouched for light and color.
Yep. And if they ask, you can give them a very similar answer to what we give people, which is
really broad range.
Yep.
Almost to the point of being unhelpful. Because again, the focus is not the sheer quantity. It's just the fact that we're going to spend time together and you're going to get all the good stuff.
Yep. But at the end of the day, there really is no one size fits all business model for every photographer. And, you know, what works for a wedding photographer in Charlottesville, Virginia, may not be the best for a newborn photographer in Minnesota or like a family photographer in London. We know there are like incredibly successful photographers on both sides of this argument.
Yeah. I once listened to a podcast of an in-person sales photographer. Every single photo he sold, $875. If you're doing that, then great. Then you're making probably better money than we are. But the thing to understand is that these business models are just fundamentally different, right? No one is necessarily better than the other, but they play to different strengths and weaknesses, both as a business person and as a photographer. So make sure that you think really seriously about this and are running the business that makes the most sense for you.
But that's it for this week.
Guys, thanks so much for watching. We really do hope that this video has helped you figure out whether in-person sales or shoot and share is going to be the better business model for you.
Yep. And if you are new to our channel, we want to make sure that you know about our Facebook community, Mastering the Wedding Photography Biz with Hunter and Sarah. This is a group where we're just building a free community of photographers who are also building their photography businesses and helping each other out along the way.
We are starting conversations in that group pretty much every day, posting content every week. And honestly, if you have questions for us, that's the best place to go, is to just join that community, ask your questions, and let us and a bunch of other great photographers answer your questions. By the way, if you liked this video, be sure to like and subscribe. So we post new content every week, and so you are the first to know.
But thanks, guys. We'll see you next week.